The Holy Spirit, the Lord, now fills the whole world. Alleluia.
The Spirit researches even the depths of God. Alleluia.
The love of God has been poured into our hearts. Alleluia.
Through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Alleluia.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, on this day you open the way of eternal life to all people by the promised gift of your Holy Spirit. Shed abroad this gift throughout the world by the preaching of the gospel, that it may reach to the ends of the earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation and under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked,
"Are not all these who are speaking Galileans?
And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language?"
Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs.
In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power.
All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another,
"What does this mean?"
But others sneered and said,
"They are filled with new wine."
But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them.
"People of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Again, your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young shall see visions, and your old shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved."
Thank you.
evening on the day of the resurrection, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the people, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." The Gospel of the Lord.
Send your Spirit, God, to open our hearts and our minds to your word and strengthen us to live according to your will, in Jesus' name. The choir singing of Psalm 104 just now reminds me of a bright spring morning in the late 1980s when I saw my first school of whales. Yonder is the great and wide sea with its living things too many to number, creatures both small and great. There move the ships, and there is that Leviathan which you have made for the sport of it. In those days, I was the vicar of St. Aidan's Episcopal Church in Malibu, California. And the California gray whales make their way south in the winter and north in the spring, passing through the Catalina Channel about 100 yards or so off the coast of Point Doom in Malibu. Up until that time, I frankly had been a bit dismissive of the popular piety in our culture about whales. But my attitude changed dramatically on that spring morning as I was running on the beach and I saw an enormous herd of gray whales round the turn off Point Doom and swim north. I had never before in my life been in the presence of something so mysterious, so other. If you've ever seen them up close, you will agree that whales are impressive creatures. They are huge. But it's not only their size that is compelling, they are also gracious and stately in their bearing. And there's one more thing. They come from someplace else, someplace we don't know. They live in the ocean. They are creatures of the earth, but they dwell in a part of the earth that is mysterious, hidden, removed from us. Looking a whale in the eye as I did on that morning is what we at Berkeley in the 1960s used to call a mind-blowing experience. When you do that, you are making contact with a creature who inhabits an entirely different reality than you do. When you do that, you are connecting with a being from someplace else. And recalling that experience reminds me of a related moment just last year. In May of 2013, the cicadas took over our world for several days. Cicadas reappear every 17 years, and they make a deafening roar. The first time I heard them, I was driving, and I thought there was something wrong with my car. Perhaps the fan belt needed replacing, or there was a cracked block or something. The sound inside the car was truly disturbing. And it was only when I stopped and got out that I realized what the sound was. The cicadas had wound themselves up into their full celebratory screech. Now, I know that there are many here who probably found that sound annoying, but for me, for some reason, I found it deeply reassuring and at times quite moving. Like the whales off the California coast, the 17-year cicadas I heard came to us from someplace else. Most of the time, they inhabit another reality than the one you and I normally see. And more than that, they are witnesses to a process and a nature that is bigger and deeper than you and I can easily imagine. This cycle of theirs, the 17 years underground, feeding on the nourishment that tree roots carry to their leaves, and then only 4 to 6 weeks above ground, singing and mating and dying in a very short spurt of time. This cycle goes on above us and beneath us and in spite of us. Its rhythms are entirely apart from us humans and the things that usually concern us. As George Harrison memorably said, life goes on within you and without you. Whales and cicadas. Now, what could they possibly have to do with Pentecost? Pentecost is today's festival, literally the 50th day. That's what Pentecost means, the 50th day of Easter. Like this holiday, our fellow creatures remind us that you and I are part of something bigger, something deeper, something more wonderful than what we usually perceive. We are in touch, if only for a moment, with the reality of a life from someplace else. Let's look at a few aspects of Pentecost this morning. This reality hidden, as Gerard Manley Hopkins said, deep down things. And let's look at the way that that reality expresses itself in the here and in the now. First, the big, deep, wonderful reality. If you were to ask me what Christianity is about, I would say that Christianity is about God's desire to be connected to us. If you read the Bible straight through, it describes the lengths to which God will go to be in relationship with human beings. God made us in the divine image, and God keeps coming back to us, keeps calling us to live life in the divine light of God's hopeful promise of joyous and abundant blessing. And that's just the Old Testament. In the New Testament, God takes that mission one step further. Jesus comes to us and lives among us and shows us what an abundant and joyful and compassionate human life looks like. Again, we people try to break that connection by taking Jesus to the cross, but once more, God's drive towards us keeps on coming. And so Jesus returns to us in the resurrection. God comes back again and again and again and again. That is one deep and perhaps the most important meaning of Easter. But Jesus' earthly presence could not last forever, and so 40 days later at Ascension, He returns to the Father and promises us an abiding presence of an advocate, a comforter. In receiving the Spirit, the Jesus movement, the community of his friends and companions, is first of all taking in the assurance that we are part of some deep, ongoing, loving process that is immensely bigger than we are and which catches us up into it. Just as at Easter, so here today at Pentecost, God has come to us. God has not left us to our own devices. God is in and among and with us. Pentecost is the newest chapter of God's ongoing drama of the search for a human connection. We matter to God. We matter so much that there is nothing we can do to remove us from God's presence. Not death, not our own faithlessness, not our worries or our fears, not anything. The big, deep reality of Pentecost is that you and I are not only connected, we are now, like Jesus, taken up into God's divine life ourselves. The Holy Spirit is not something abstract and gaseous floating around in the sky someplace. The Holy Spirit is the living presence of God in and among and with us. So how does that ongoing divinity express itself in us here and now? I still remember, even though it's a few years ago, Werner Herzog's great film, The Cave of Forgotten Dreams. A beautiful movie filmed in the caves of southern France, where the paintings on the walls they discovered there are around 30,000 years old. At one point in the movie, Werner Herzog interviews an ethnologist as he tries to understand the creative process of pre-modern people. The ethnologist quotes what an Australian Aborigine artist said to him when he was asked why he was painting on a rock. The Aboriginal artist said, "I am not painting. The hand of the Spirit is painting." Pentecost is about the hand of that Spirit guiding us in our lives. It's not only the whales and the cicadas who are in touch with life's rhythms. It's not only the Aboriginal artist who can feel the hand of the Spirit in his work as he paints. You and I can do that too. We now together have been given the gift of the Spirit, and that means that you and I, like Jesus and like that artist, have been taken up into God. We are not just watching something from the outside. We are in it. We are part of what we proclaim. Again, listen to Psalm 104. Yonder is the great and wide sea, and with its living things too many to number, creatures both small and great. There move the ships, and there is that Leviathan, which you have made for the sport of it. Or as our prayer book antiphon for morning prayer says it, the Spirit of the Lord renews the face of the earth. The ongoing life of Jesus and his presence among us now are what Pentecost really means. They are God's ongoing gifts to you and me. We together embody God's life and God's purpose in the world. Your life is as connected to the depths of reality as are the lives of the mysterious creatures who dwell in the deep of the sea or under the earth. Your life is as connected to God as were those of Jesus' companions who knew firsthand the Spirit's rushing wind and tongues of fire. Let each of us embrace that presence and feel that wind and hear those tongues. And then let us together move out in a Pentecost blessing. so that in and with God and Christ and each other, we may begin to paint the world with the hand of the Spirit. Amen.
It's a holy parade. The candidates for holy baptism will now be presented.
We present Addie Simone Laurent to receive the sacrament of baptism.
We present Blake Bradley Rosenthal to receive the sacrament of baptism.
We present Sophia Ariane Todd to receive the sacrament of baptism.
We present Meredith Leslie Gordy to receive the sacrament of baptism.
We present Caleb Francis Robers to receive the sacrament of baptism.
Will you be responsible for seeing that the child you present is brought up in the Christian faith and life? Will you, by your prayers and witness, help this child to grow into the full stature of Christ? Do you renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God? Do you renounce the evil powers of this world which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God? Do you renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior? Do you put your whole trust in his grace and love? Do you promise to follow and obey him as your Lord? Please stand as you are able. Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support these persons in their life in Christ? Let us join with Meredith, Addie, Caleb, Blake, and Zofia, who are committing themselves to Christ, and reaffirm our own baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in the prayers?
I will, with God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
I will, with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God and Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people, and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
Let us pray for Meredith, Addie, Caleb, Blake, and Sophia, who are to receive the sacrament of new birth. Deliver them, O Lord, from the way of sin and death. Lord, hear our prayer. Open their hearts to your grace and truth. Lord, hear our prayer. Fill them with your holy and life-giving Spirit. Lord, hear our prayer. Keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church. Lord, hear our prayer. Teach them to love others in the power of the Spirit. Lord, hear our prayer. Send them into the world in witness to your love. Lord, hear our prayer. Fullness of your peace and glory. Lord, hear our prayer. Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns now and forever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
We thank you, O God, for the gift of water. Over it the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. Through it, you led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt into the land of promise. In it, your son, Jesus, received the baptism of John and was anointed by the Holy Spirit as the Messiah, the Christ, to lead us through his death and resurrection from the bondage of sin into everlasting life. We thank you, O God, for the water of baptism, which signifies our eternal covenant with you. In it we are buried with Christ in its death. By it we share in his resurrection. Through it we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to Christ, we bring into his fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. We pray you, O God, sanctify this water by the power of your Holy Spirit, that those who hear are cleansed from sin and born again may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Savior. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen.
Okay, Meredith. Up, baby. All right, sweetie. This will be okay. Oh, hey, sweetheart. Meredith, right? Meredith, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Meredith, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism, and marked as Christ's own forever.
Amen.
Meredith, receive this light of Christ and let it burn brightly in your life all your days.
Amen. Amen.
Addie, will you come to me? Here we go. Addie, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Addie, be sealed with the Holy Spirit in baptism and be Christ's own forever. Amen. Addie, receive the light of Christ and shine the light of your life into all the world. Amen.
I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Caleb, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in your baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. This. Caleb, receive the light of Christ and let it illumine your life as you illumine others and carry it out into a hurting and suffering world.
Blake. Right. I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blake, Blake, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. Blake, receive the light of Christ. Let it burn brightly in your life all your days. Amen.
Sophia. Hi there, dear.
Hi.
Hey there. Hey there. How are you? You can come up if you want to. Sophia, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Go ahead, you take her. We can still finish.
Sophia, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism, and marked as Christ's own forever. See if you like this. Sophia, receive the light of Christ and shine with your light in all the world. Amen. It's fine.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you that by water and the Holy Spirit, you have bestowed upon these your servants the forgiveness of sin, and have raised them to the new life of grace. Sustain them, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Give them inquiring and discerning hearts, the courage to will and to persevere, a spirit to know and to love you,
in the gift of joy and wonder in all your works. Amen. Amen. Let us welcome the newly baptized.
We receive
you into the household of God. Confess the faith of Christ crucified. Proclaim his resurrection. And share with us in his eternal priesthood.
God has made us one in Christ. God has set God's seal upon us and, as a pledge of what is to come, has given the Spirit to dwell in our hearts. Alleluia. The peace of Christ be always with you.
Good morning and welcome again to Washington National Cathedral. Please be seated for a couple of announcements. Those of us who wear glasses probably should bring tissues on Sundays when we do baptism. I'm Gary Hall, the Dean, and on behalf of Bishop Buddy and all who regularly worship and work and volunteer here, it is my great privilege to welcome you to our cathedral for the service of Pentecost, a holy baptism and Holy Eucharist. Whoever you are and wherever you find yourself on the journey of faith, you are welcome at God's table to receive the bread and wine of communion. The ushers will direct you to the communion stations around the church. If you would rather receive a blessing than receive communion, please let us know that by folding your arms this way across your chest. After you've come forward to the communion station, you're invited to go to War Memorial Chapel, which is on the south side of the nave. And there we have our healing ministers will be there, and they will give you the laying on of healing, laying on of hands for healing, and they will pray with you for your own needs and concerns, the needs and concerns you may have for your loved ones, for the nation, and for the world. After the service, over in the West End, we have cold refreshments, and you're invited to greet each other at that time. One big announcement this morning, and that is that we're on a fiscal year here at the Cathedral, and which closes June 30th. And our congregation, the members of our worshiping community here, reliably give us about $1 million of the $13 million of our annual operating budget. This year, we're about $70,000 behind at this moment in June. And so in response to that, two members of our congregation have generously pledged, offered to match any new pledges or gifts to this congregation campaign, which are made between now and June 30th, up to $25,000. So if you can help us get to that $1 million goal for the fiscal year by taking an envelope, and they're located at the congregation table at the back of the nave following the service. And if you give between now and June 30th, the impact of your gift will be doubled. God has been generous to us in so many ways, and we respond now to God's generosity by giving to support the mission and the ministry that God does through the church and through this cathedral. So let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and our labor to God.
Adorum, de mihi adorum, de mihi adorum.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, in fulfillment of his true promise, the Holy Spirit came down on this day from heaven, lighting upon the disciples to teach them and to lead them into all truth. Uniting peoples of many tongues in the confession of one faith, and giving to your church the power to serve you as a royal priesthood and to preach the gospel to all nations. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you've made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you've delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O God, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son and his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with Mary, the mother of Jesus, Peter, Paul, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. As we join our prayers with those of the Church Universal,
So we say, each in our own language, the prayer that Jesus Christ has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Let us pray. Faithful God, who fulfilled the promises of Easter by sending us your Holy Spirit and opening to all people the way of life eternal, open our lips by your Spirit, that every tongue may tell of your glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Spirit who hovered over the waters when the world was created breathe into you Spirit life. Amen. May the Spirit who overshadowed Mary when the eternal Son came among us make you joyful in the service of the Lord. Amen. May the Spirit who set the church on fire upon the day of Pentecost bring the world alive with the love of the risen Christ. In the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always.
Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Alleluia.